especially to our friends and worshippers who are online with us today. We thank God. I have to also mention that the readings are actually different from the ones in your booklets, so you have to really listen today to the wonderful words of Scripture. We gather to worship in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Christ calls us to share the heavenly banquet of his love with all the saints in earth and heaven. Knowing our unworthiness and sin, let us ask from him both mercy and forgiveness.
Forgives all who truly repent. Have mercy upon you, pardon, and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. To be subject to his just and gentle rule, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
turned out all right in the end, didn't they? I couldn't play the miracle, but actually, what it was my mistake. I did quite a job. Well, there we go. Have you been following this COP26? It's been difficult to avoid. But for really 3 decades, the UN has been bringing together almost every country on Earth for global climate summits, for COPs. Anybody know what it stands for? Conference of Parties. Called COPs. And in that time, the climate change has gone from being a fringe issue to being a global priority. COPs 1 to 20 were much COP. Nobody thinks to remember much of what went on in them until the one in Paris in 2015. But now, everybody is talking about it, and the issues are so complicated and involves difficult science. And I want today to try and just think about some of the basic, our relationship with God and life, how that might inform our attitude to all of this. I used to love a coal fire, and I used to love looking at it, and then in the 60s, I used to have to grope my way to school through the sulfurous fumes of something that was not called fog, because it was sulfurous, it was called smog, and we could hardly breathe. And then 50 years later, I'm standing in Tiananmen Square, and I can't see across it. And what do I suddenly smell? It's that same smell that I smelt all those years ago. Sulfur again. As the song goes, when will we ever learn? I'm not good at change. I don't know about you. Find change difficult. But I think I've really got to address changing myself in some way. Because at the moment, I confess to you, I've been something of a hypocrite about the world. It's easy to excuse ourselves, isn't it? The economics of this all are so complicated. People do a lot of double counting. They send off trees to another country, the other country counts that as a saving, and we count it as a saving, and it gets all very complicated. The science becomes very difficult to understand. A few years ago we were all commanded to plant trees, but now we hear perhaps that saving moors, salt marshes and seagrass, it would soak up 10 times the carbon that a tree would. We've been obsessed by carbon dioxide, but it's only one of the components of the gases that are warming our world. Methane, 40% of that is in those gases. We've only just really started to measure that. So dazed and confused, I'm tempted just to forget it all. To say it's too complicated for me, it's above my pay grade. But I know with my heart, I cannot. Doing nothing is not an option. As the gospel according to Tesco says, every little helps. You may be relieved to know that today I'm not instructing you to do any particular thing. Whether it's planting a tree or travelling south of Carshalton and gluing your cheeks to the entrance of the slipway. I just want us to stand back a minute and consider quietly what our Christian viewpoint might be about all this. Where might our thinking start? Planting a tree is a promising idea. But I think we also need to plant and grow our love for God, our Creator, Do you remember that first and great lockdown that we started with? When we went out every day and there were almost no cars. I received a picture from the Southern Cathedral taken from the roof, showing London as I had never seen it, with crystal clear views right to the suburbs and across the skyscrapers. And we all went out and we found joy, didn't we? We sent pictures to one another of butterflies. We sent pictures of daffs in the churchyard and blossom in our backyards. And of course, a thousand odd photos of cats and dogs. But we looked at creation and we saw that it was good, so good. And we were experiencing, perhaps for the first time, what our Father, the creator of the universe, experienced when he created it. He kept being gobsmacked at what he'd done, at the beauty of it. And again in Genesis, he proclaims, "Oh, this is good. It's very, very good." And as Christians, find the first reason we do is to look to keep our world in a good state so that we can see the glory of God. Might that be the first reason to look at how we look after this world? Creation can be almost a sacrament, an outward sign of God's goodness, God's beauty, and his creative love. Listen to Pope Francis meditating on on Saint Francis in his encyclical Laudato Si'. He says this: "Praise be to you, my Lord, through our sister Mother Earth, who sustains and governs us, and who produces various fruit with coloured flowers and herbs. This sister now cries out to us, because of the harm we have inflicted on her by our irresponsible use and abuse of the goods which God has endowed her. We have come to see ourselves as her lords and masters, entitled to plunder her at will. The violence present in our hearts, wounded by sin, is also reflected in the symptoms of sickness evident in the soil, in the water, in the air, and in all forms of life. This is why the earth herself, burdened and laid waste, is among the most abandoned and maltreated of our all. As it says in Romans 8, the whole creation groans in travail." So while we are caring for our globe, it might help us to see again our Father God in all his goodness. Genesis chapter 2 verse 15 tells us that God took the man, put him in a garden, and said, "Work it and take care of it." He said, "Rape it, pillage it, dig it up and forget it, but take care of it." And we're reminded that we are caretakers of this earth, we're not pillagers. Psalm 24 reminds us joyfully, "The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it." That's why we love it. We are the Lord's. The earth is the Lord's. Everything that is in it is also the Lord's. Not ours to bring it to light. We are stewards. God rejects every claim of ours to absolute ownership of our earth, land, whatever. The land, it says in Leviticus, shall not be sold in perpetuity, for the land is mine. You are strangers and sojourners to me.
When I was speaking many years ago
in Durham, There were potato fields outside the town, and after the main harvest, the local people could go on the land and glean what was left behind. It was a biblical practice. I don't know whether it still exists there, but those who tilled and kept the land were obliged to share its food. And in ancient Israel, that was especially with the poor, the widows, the orphans, and the foreigners in this. It's an application in Durham of a tradition going all the way back to the Leviticus. Pope Francis again, Pope Francis, the best way to restore men and women to their rightful place, putting an end to their claim of absolute dominion over the earth, is to speak once more of the figure of the Father who creates and alone owns this world. Our planets, I think, will begin to, our planet will begin to flourish and blossom when there are no deserts in our hearts where God should be. We would do better to worship our Father God than the gross domestic product. People can be freer to fulfill, to live fulfilled lives when we are released from our self-imposed slavery to the bottom line. Finally, another uncomplicated way we can think about this is to remember again that if God is my Father, then like Christ, all humans are also sacred as God's children. You are my brothers and sisters of everybody out there on this planet. My brothers and my sisters. Would I leave my sister to be flooded? My brother to be consumed by fire? Each of us are created, lifted, and coming from this created world as a universe. And our brothers and sisters are part of us and part of God. And I would like to look away, but I can't. Can I blind myself to my brother holding on to the roof of his house as the monsoon sweeps him away? Can I refuse to limit my calm? Can I avoid seeing my sister in Australia as she burns and refuses to insulate my house? I cannot look at my cousin in the Pacific Islands and watch their island drown. I want to refuse to look at my part in all of this, but I think God is calling me not to avoid it. It's so much easier for me to just blame our politicians than look at myself and see what I have said and what I fail to see. I need to address my own little and big hypocrisies. And I really need to apologize for moaning and being in my bicycles. I am wondering, perhaps if I should say grace at meals much more often than I do, that might realign my relationship to God's will, to what is really the case, that it's His food that I'm eating. Perhaps I should also say grace when I get in my car and think of the power that is there at my fingertips. I'd say thank you when I turn on my light. Our Mass calls us to be in harmony with God. And we do it through the breaking of the bread. And it's a wonderful gift. Let us go from here and be God's gift to our world. For God said to Noah this. He said to Noah, I establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the cattle, every beast of the earth with you. Everything
we are linked to and responsible to God for. Let us go and be God's gift to our lovely world on this lovely autumn day. Amen. I believe in one God, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, the Son of the Father before the world, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men, for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again in glory to judge the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. United in the company of all the faithful and looking for the coming of the kingdom, let us offer our prayers to God, the source of all life.
Creator God, we thank you for the beauty of your creation. We pray for the national leaders and the groups who are attending the COP 26 summit. We pray that those that are made will be just and fair for all nations. We pray you will have the wisdom and the courage to make the decisions that may both stop and reverse the damage that has been done to your world.
For ourselves,
that each of us will also have the wisdom and the courage to make choices and changes
in the way that we live, to lessen the damage
that we may inadvertently be a part of causing.
Foster within all of the church
a renewed vision of your purposes for your world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Of your purposes in our lives.
May we also be ready to follow
wherever you lead.
In the words and prayers of Ignatius of Loyola, teach us the Lord
to serve you as you deserve, give and not to count the cost, fight and not to keep the rules,
toil and not to seek the rest,
and ask for no reward. Except for your will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father God, we pray for our families,
our friends, our neighbours, and we
remember those who have been baptised.
We pray for your loving
blessings.
saints, and of the household of God, through Christ our Lord, who came and preached peace to those who were far off and to those who were near.
The peace of the Lord be always with you, and with thy spirit.
Let's offer each other a socially distant sign of Christ's peace.
where heaven and earth unite, may Jesus meet us in the breaking of the bread. Amen.
So, Father,
we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence, his sacrifice, made once for all upon the cross.
Bring it before you, the
bread of life and cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory.
Great is the mystery of faith.
Justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favor on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with Blessed Mary and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ.
In the unity of the Holy Spirit,
all honor and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever. Away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to be suffered.
Lord, I am not
worthy that thou should come under my roof, but speak the word only that my soul shall be. Thank you.
Thank you.
God of peace, whose Son, Jesus Christ, proclaimed the kingdom and restored the broken to wholeness of life, look with compassion on the anguish of the world,
and by your healing power,
make
whole both people and the nations, through our Lord and Savior,
Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please do have a look at the notices in the corner on the notice sheet to see all of our normal service times this week. This evening we have choral evensong at 6:30 with the full choir singing, so please do come along to that if you can. Next Sunday there will be no 9 a.m. all age mass or a 10:30 mass. Instead we'll have one service at 9:45 because it's Remembrance Sunday. So next Sunday, one service at 9:45 for Remembrance Sunday. This coming Thursday, our local MP, Elliot Colburn, is using the church to hold a moped crime public meeting. That's this Thursday, the 11th of November at 7 p.m. If you have any concerns about moped crime or any other crime, please do come here then. This coming Saturday on the 13th of November, we have Haydn's The Creation being played here in church, which is incredibly exciting, at 7:30 p.m. Tickets are £15 for adults. I think you can book that online. Aside from that, I think they are all the notices.
God give to you and to all those whom you love his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and the next, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Thanks be to God.